Par contre, elle comprend parfaitement le français, donc si vous pouvez poser vos questions en français, et s'il y a des doutes ou des questions, tout le monde dit, enfin tout le monde, quelques-uns pour se charger d'éventuellement traduire les difficultés. Donc n'hésitez pas à poser vos questions, même si la présentation est en anglais. Donc on va l'organisation un petit peu là de cette deuxième partie. Saskia va faire sa présentation. On laissera quelques minutes de questions, mais assez brièvement. Ensuite, Isabelle Graff fera la deuxième présentation de la matinée. Et on se gardera une demi-heure vraiment complète de débats et de questions sur l'ensemble des deux exposés globalement. Donc je laisse la parole à Saskia. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me here to speak about what's happening in open access in Europe. I'm going to explain to you what the European Commission is planning to do. And I want to start by saying that I don't agree to it before you all fall over me. Then I'll tell you what's happening in the Netherlands with the offsetting big deals, which are horrible, but I will explain them to you. And there's a lot going on in Germany as well. And then we come to the more positive parts. I'll give you an introduction to our fair open access principles, which were already a little bit explained by Benoît. And I will tell you a little more about the Open Library of Humanities as well, because they are very involved in it. So this is the agenda. 2 weeks ago, Bergelman, one of the commissioners at the European Commission, did a presentation, which is his presentation, on the systemic transition of science systems they are hoping for. And as you can see, they want research to be performed, knowledge to be shared, research projects to be evaluated, research is funded, researchers are rewarded, and future researchers should be trained. And they think this will affect the whole research circle and all its stakeholders. And they do think it's going to be a disruptive and hence disturbing action. They have 8 priorities. 4 of them are for the results and the data, which are not very interesting for us. It's the open data, the science cloud, and the metrics, which they want to add. But the future of scholarly communication is very important because they want all peer-reviewed scientific publications freely accessible. They also have regards with relation to research actors. So they want a new reward system. They want research integrity, education and skills, and citizen science is going to be more important. Benoît already told you about the 2 main open access models. One is the green one called self-archiving, basically, and the other one is the gold one, which is the very often seen as the author pay model. I'll come back to that. Open access is not an obligation to publish. It's not at odds with patenting, and open publications go through the same peer review system as non-open access publications. There's a lot of discussion about that too. The Commission wants to have an obligation to provide open access, either through the green or the gold way, but they do allow embargoes, 6 months for STEM and 12 months for the humanities. They have a specific pilot through Open Air, and the authors are encouraged to retain copyrights, but they are not pushed to do so. The Commission wants to lead the example after the 2 things which were last year. And at this moment, it's about 60-68% of scientific publications in open access. So they need further measures to achieve their target, 100% by 2020. So what they have thought about, and it's very much in line with the Wellcome Trust, which Benoît mentioned, or the Gates project. They want to make an online platform which allows rapid open access publication of all 2020-related peer-reviewed articles and also 2020-related preprints which meet basic criteria on authorship, non-plagiarism and ethical conduct. It will contain mechanisms for open peer review and a suite of innovative alternative metrics. They say it's not a repository. You can discuss it, and it provides a fast, cost-effective, and high-quality service to publish in the 21st century, and it's intended for only Horizon 2020 beneficiaries as a free complementary service, and so it will not be compulsory. as we have seen with the Wellcome Trust Foundation or the platform, they published it about a year ago. There are only 120 articles on it, which have to still be peer-reviewed. It's a post-publication peer review. And the big problem is that there are not many authors who want to publish on a platform which doesn't have any quality yet. So we think, and now I'm talking from the Fair Open Access Alliance, we don't think this will work. Because if an author can choose between publishing in Nature or another high-impact journal, or on a publication platform, which is basically a repository, they won't go there. The European Commission is going to put 6.4 million euros into this project in the next three or four years, which is zero money, of course, if you look at what the European Commission has. But the big problem is that everybody can apply to the call, and we already have heard that Springer is going to apply. So if this goes wrong, then there is a big problem. The problem is not as big as we think, because 6 million for the European Commission is still a very small amount of money on the total research. But at the Fair Open Access Alliance, we are really looking into how we can somehow prevent the commercial publishers to get the money and to influence what's happening. And on the other hand, try to extend our Mathoa and Lingoa projects. I'll come back to that later. Wacht even. Nou, I already said. Oh yeah. So they do say that the success of the platform depends on the quality. So, but when we ask them, how can you get that quality there, they don't really know how to do it. And so they say, we are not a scientific publisher, yeah?
I have to mention they're wrong. It has nothing to do with the quality of the scientific publication service provided. It has everything to do with the prestige with publishing there.
Of course, exactly. And they call it a service on par with the highest quality standards of scientific publishing can only be provided by outsourcing the implementation of the platform through a fully transparent public process, which they will do. So they will announce the call, publish the call next month, and then next year, I think before March, all the proposals shall have to come in. They also think that we will have a very different open research workflows, which we do agree to. So let me now get to another disaster. It's the open access offsetting deals in the Netherlands. I'll start by saying a little more about the two gold and green routes. Benoît said, there was a report in Open Air which has put actually four different routes. What they say is there is the green route, which is the archiving. Then you have the hybrid gold open access route, which is basically double dipping. If you, as a publisher, ask an abonnement and you ask it for the same journal for articles, you ask for APCs, that's called double dipping. Then you have gold open access via OPCs alone, so fully open access journals without a subscription that require a payment from an author, institution, or funder. But there's also the gold open access without APCs, and we really shouldn't forget that. They don't ask money to their authors. They will have to be paid, of course, there are costs, but not through their authors. There are four different types of open access offsetting arrangements worldwide that have been put in place. You can have a local reduction from a fee of the total amount of all APCs, revenue from the previous year. You can have a cap whereby subscriptions are maintained, but subscribing organizations pay no extra. Yeah?
Could you precise offsetting? I'm not sure it's clear to everyone.
Okay. What's happening in Holland right now is that we have big deals with all the major publishers, and they were only for subscription until now. So it wasn't a subscription model. What Holland, the Netherlands, has been doing is they have been talking to all these publishers and saying, look, we want the open access publishing to be included in this deal. Basically, they said, and we will not pay more for it. Well, of course they do now. I'll show you the figures. But the idea was that if a country, as the Netherlands, 13 universities have a deal with Springer, then all articles published with a Dutch, a Netherlands author as the first author are allowed into their journals, and there's no extra pay for the author, which is a good idea if you could get the price down. But the problem is, and you'll see the charts hereafter, right? This is too small, I know, but you can have my you can get my presentation. There was an act of open information call because, of course, all these deals were closed. And what you can see is that in nearly every case, we are paying more, and we are not getting open access to all the journals of the publisher. So what they say is, okay, you can publish your article in 50% of our journals, and they pick the worst 50%, not the Nature or Science. So we are still not getting what we want and paying more. And then the deal with Elsevier was even worse. For Elsevier, they were really proud. They announced, we have a deal. But in the deal with Elsevier, in the first year, the authors are allowed to publish in 10% of Elsevier journals, in the second in 20%, and in the third, 30%. And the fees still go up for 2.5% and 2%. So it's just paying more and more and not getting what we want. The Association of Dutch Universities by now has actually agreed that this is not the way to go. They now call it a transition state. And they just don't know how to go further, I think. It's really basically a problem. What is happening in Germany is also interesting, because they are doing the same offsetting licensing with the big publishers, but this is their goal. You can find it on their website. It's trying to find a way to get the open access into the deal. But the deal Elsevier came up with somewhere late last year was so bad that a lot of universities said, we don't want this deal. So they cancelled their subscription. And then, I think that were 50 or 60 in the beginning. And then Elsevier shut those institutions off in February, thinking there would be a huge outcry from scientists. But there was nobody complaining, because they could get their articles by library loans or any other way. So then Elsevier opened it up again. So right now, which is really good, more than 200 libraries and universities in Germany are not paying Elsevier, and they still have access. So this is what we think, Fair Open Access Alliance, not Netherlands, we think that the Netherlands should do too. So there's a new arrangement with Elsevier soon, and you should have the guts to say, if you don't like the deal, we have no deal, fine. And then, that's the only way to get better deals. Well, that's pretty obvious. And the other thing which is happening in Germany, which is also nice, there are 7 or 8 renowned scientists who have officially said to Elsevier, we will not work for you anymore. We won't edit, we were editors on a journal, we will pull ourselves back. We are telling everybody around us, don't do the peer review and don't send any articles in. This is just the beginning, I think. There will be much more editors doing that. And for example, in Finland, let me see, they have more than 7,000 members of the Finnish academia who have said, we don't want to work for Elsevier unless they come up with a good deal. So the nice thing is that you are seeing that not only top-down, the universities or the rectors are organizing themselves, but also the authors and the editors. Which brings me to our fair open access model, and maybe I should explain the fair part, because Johan and I came up with it, because there is something unfair in the system, which is that an author or an academic is the one who is paid by a university with public money. He does his work, or she makes an article, she delivers it for nothing to the publisher, who by now does nothing with it anymore, just put it in a sort of container, and then they resell it to the library. This is an unfair system. But I agree, it should be efficace, was that the word? Yeah, okay. So, the Fair Open Access model is a bottom-up business model, which involves editors and existing journals and libraries in the process, and we think it's a strong incentive for commercial publishers to accept terms that are more favorable for academia in the ongoing negotiations for these open access offsetting big deals. We have a little different model, but it's basically a bit the same. If you look at the classical journal publishing model, it's very publisher-centric. The publisher calls the shots, owns the journal titles, sets pricing and conditions, and they control everything. It's very dualistic by now. As you know, it's nearly it's publishers against researchers and libraries. The researchers pay for access to journal articles, and it's subscription-based. The fair open access publishing model, there the researchers are centric. They call the shots. As always, they are author, reviewer, and they edit, but the editors or learned societies own the journal titles and use publication service providers to make articles available at low costs. Researchers own their copyrights, and the university library provides editorial assistance, storage, and publications fees. I'll come back to that a little later. It's pluralistic. We work together on fair conditions. The producer pays, so editors or university libraries pay for the article processing charges with public money, and the university libraries pay for the real production cost of online publishing. So if you look at the model, you see how it shifts from the classical model to the fair open access model. And we think that if we do this in the right way, we can use the money which is in the subscription fees to pay for, and it's not really the article processing charge, but the prices of open access. So, the conditions were already explained to you in French, so I can skip this. And I can go to the, well, our sort of proof of the pudding is Lingoa. We have four journals in linguistics who flipped away from their publisher in most ways to an publisher who agreed to our fair open access principles. The Journal of Portuguese Linguistics was owned by the University of Porto, and they agreed to go to Ubiquity Press, which is a small publisher in England. Laboratory Phonology was with De Gruyter. Their contract was stopping anyway, so they could stop the contract and move away, and the Learned Society owned the title, which was really very good. And the Italian Journal of Linguistics is published by Pacini, and they agreed to our principles, but actually the most interesting one, and it's probably the one you've heard of, is Lingua from Elsevier. The complete editorial board of Lingua asked Elsevier for the fair open access conditions. Obviously Elsevier said no, and then they moved away, 32 people at one day, and they set up a new journal called Glossa, which is Greek for Lingua. And it's really interesting to see, and this is old news, by now they have already nearly 100 published articles and 70 in production. So the authors in this field are very clear that they will submit their articles now at Glossa within a year. So in our view, the flipping proceeds in two stages. The transition of 3 years. The editorial board asks the publisher to comply with the conditions of fair open access. If the publisher refuses, and we hope that at some point they won't refuse because they can't anymore, but if they refuse now, the editorial board leaves and sets up a new journal with the publisher who does apply. And what we need is APCs paid for a three-year fund. For Lingua, the fund is financed by the NBO and the Association of Dutch Universities, and the Radboud University Library provides a journal manager for the 4 years. So you need some money to flip the system. And the final stage, after 3 years, the journals will have reestablished their impact factors and indices.
It seems to me there is one ingredient missing, which is the learned society, or the non-profit organization which makes the link. You should find it. In case of Italian linguistics, there was, but...
Yeah, but we actually see the edit. I'm speaking a lot about the editors, but we mean the academic societies, so that can be a learned society. For Glossa, the editorial board set up a so-called association in Holland, a stichting, to be sure that it was sort of well-governed. And you can also, Labfon had a learned society behind them who owned the title. So I agree. I should mention learned society more in the presentation because we see a very big role for them. And there is also a problem because there are a lot of learned societies who own a lot of money through the old model. So they are sometimes even worse than the publisher because they don't want to lose their income. But there are, especially in humanities and social sciences, I hope a lot of learned societies who don't get any money. And even, in my opinion, if the learned society gets some money, they invest it in their subject. It doesn't go to a shareholder somewhere outside. It stays the same for university presses. A university press puts the money back into academia, which is better anyway. So in the final stage, the journals will have re-established their impact factor, and the APCs will be paid by a consortium of libraries. And here we come to the Open Library of Humanities, which Benoit already mentioned. So it's a non-profit, academic-led, open-access publisher for humanities and social sciences. It promotes flipping subscription journals to open access. It's a very nice library consortium model. So a library pays very little money, just between 500 and 1,500 euros, and that pays for all the APCs of OLH-associated journals, so that the author does not have to find that money. The libraries, as Benoit mentioned, also vote on which journals to admit. There's a peer review quality control process first, organized by OLH. When the peer review of the journal is good enough, it goes to the consortium and they can vote. Until now, I think they only voted down two journals. So it's a sort of nice growing model. Oh. I think it's now 250 libraries which participate. And I know you are all maths people, but maybe you could think about joining OLH anyway, because we need more money to grow. And they subscribe to the Fair Open Access principles, and they actually want to work with any publisher who also does so. So it's up to the publishers to now change their models. So this provides a long-term sustainable solution for flipping existing journals from subscription to fair open access and enabling libraries to redirect funds from subscription to open access.
Just to say, there are a lot of people here who are mathematical librarians, but they also are in contact with their university libraries. So you
Please.
Could ask your libraries to join OLH. Parlez-en à vos SCD.
We have very little French members. So it would be nice to get some French people on board. I know because in Holland we have three technical universities who are not member of OLH either. In the future, of course, we want to expand OLH to become an open library of sciences because we need this money for Mathoa as well. So, but that needs extra money to make that possible. So it's discipline based. That's the nice thing. We work within Lingua. I'm going to say a little more about Mathoa. We're also looking at a COA. So what we do is we set up a foundation that helps flipping existing subscription journals to fair open access. The existing networks within the disciplines, which are the editors and the authors and the peer reviews, are exploited to influence editors to flip their journal to fair open access. There are no author-facing article processing charges. The foundation pays for the APCs during the transition period. It also covers legal costs. We had to hire a lawyer in Germany when Elsevier was asked to let Lingua go. And in the long term, it's sustainable because we have the Open Library of Humanities, which takes over all costs of the open access. So the library funds are redirected from subscription to APCs. And I always really like this chart because if you look at costs of, for example, one journal with 100 articles subscribed to 400 libraries at an average subscription fee of 2,000 a year, and you go over to a model with an article processing charge or open access fee of 1,000 euro per article, you see that in the subscription model, the total for the 400 libraries is 800,000 euros. In the fair open access transition period, you need a little more money, but at the fair open access final stage, I think I can point this here, you see that the price has gone down by 1/8. So if you look at this, this is not possible to do in one 3-year time for all journals in the world. But you can see how much money is locked into these subscription fees, which we should get out of. We are also looking at flipping existing national journals to fair open access, so the more local national ones. We're doing this in Holland, in Sweden, and in Switzerland. These journals also have big problems, very often even being sustained in the subscription model, and we're trying to get them to also join the OLH library consortium model. The OLH is also interested in journals in other languages than English. Specifically, and so we think the discipline OAS should form an alliance, which is the Fair Open Access Alliance. We now have MAFOA, which is already a stichting as well, and PSIOA. In each discipline, 3 reputed journals are ready to flip. This requires transition funds from university consortia, and I think I know that your organization is putting up some money, which is great for funding, yeah, for Jalco, which I'll say more about. The Open Library Consortium model must be expanded beyond the humanities, of course. And so we've set up the Fair Open Access Alliance. The Lingua flipping model provide. Oh, no, MAFOA has started. I think you all have heard that the Journal of Algebraic Combinatorics, if I say it correctly, has left, or the editors have resigned from Springer, and there's a new journal called very simple Algebraic Combinatorics, ALCAL, and the first, I think, 20 articles have already been submitted, and I think...
I think we are more than like 40 submissions. Wow. On some, more than 30, I'm sure. I don't know if we hit the 40, and there are 4 articles that were able to be accepted already.
And the first issue will be published early next year, with Marcin, who are here. Hi, haven't met you yet. what we did here was, and we did this with Glossa as well, because the editors had to sit out their period until the end of the year, we found an external editor in chief for the time being, who's handling the articles. And what you also see, which is great, is that a lot of authors which had subscriptions with Lingua or with Vialco already in peer review, but not a contract yet, they pulled it back and they resubmitted it at the new editor. So it's really very much discipline-based. You want the authors to help each other, to tell each other, and there's lots of things going on about it on Facebook. Okay, I'm finishing. The Lingua flipping model provides a tested roadmap for flipping subscription journals to fair open access. The investment in the funding for the transition period is temporary, and the long-term savings are substantial, as I showed you in the chart about the 400 libraries. Plus, there will be a downward pressure on APCs and open access publishing costs. The consortia on the model of the Open Library Humanities enable library funds to be redirected. And the change to fair open access is bottom-up. That's what I like most. It's driven by editorial boards and by libraries. We really need to involve the academics and, well, libraries have a very big role here as well. And the academics face no costs for publication. This was my talk. You can find us here. If there's any, you're talking now, but if there's anything specific you didn't understand, there's 1 minute. No? It was
even
clear.
2 minutes.
That's fine, okay.
Je rajoute juste rapidement qu'effectivement le RNBM et l'INSMI en tant que tel réfléchit à la façon de financer MAFOA, enfin de participer au financement de la fondation. On a des difficultés administratives pour formaliser la chose, mais en tout cas il y a un désir fort de participer à la chose. C'est un peu compliqué administrativement, mais je pense qu'on peut y arriver.
Arrivé. Ouais, ça a comme...